Cell 411 is a free app for Android and iOS that replaces government-controlled 911. Cell 411 allows you to preset a group of friends or private organizations to show up in any emergency. Cell 411 is a nightmare for the state because it proves their so-called services aren't needed. Cell 411 has had thousands of installs, and of course, it's covered by the BIPCOT no government license. Cell 411 because your friends won't shoot you when you're in trouble. Without the government, who would build the emergency services? You and Cell 411. Get it today at GetCell411.com. That's GetCell411.com.
Are you tired of your taxes funding endless occupations around the world? Antiwar.com is run by people who understand that wars abroad become wars at home, wars on our freedoms. Antiwar.com is dedicated to bringing you the latest in news, views, interviews, and reviews from the top movers and shakers in the anti-occupation movement. Antiwar.com has it all, from thorough foreign policy analysis to interviews with whistleblowers who used to run the military-industrial complex. Anti-war, pro-free market. That's Antiwar.com.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to the 107th episode of the Seeds of Liberty podcast. As always, we are covered by a BIPCOT no government license. This allows reuse by anyone except governments and the agents thereof. You can find out more information about this at BIPCOT.org. So we are back. I am Jeremy. I am joined, as always, by Dave and Andre. Hey, guys, what's up?
Hey, what's going on, man?
Not much, but I don't know. I shouldn't say not much. It's actually been a very fun day for me. Started off bad, but it turned out great. We'll get into that later. this week, we are brought to you by Discord. Unfortunately, I thought we were going to be brought to you by Fiendphone this week, but the gods were not smiling upon us tonight. More on that later as well. And as always, we are also now brought to you by Room for Freedom, the kick-ass website and app by Ben Stone, the Bad Quaker, that is going to beat Airbnb into the ground. That's not an actual tagline. That's just my personal one, so nothing I say can be held against Room for Freedom. But go check them out at roomforfreedom.com. Really big fan of what Ben's trying to do, and I want to help him out in any way that I can. So please go check them out and consider donating to the new Indiegogo campaign that is getting up and running and is going to be much better organized than the last one that was kind of thrown together haphazardly. So go check that out. All right. So this week, we have Scott and Adam from the ANCAP Barbershop stopping by to join us. And these guys, this is a podcast that our friend Nick Hazelton actually turned me on to originally, because I think they had him on very early on. And Nick was talking about them, and I'm like, hey, I'll give them a listen. And I really enjoyed their stuff. Very well-produced podcast. Really good content. You know, I always enjoy listening to it. So welcome, guys. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you, man. Thank you. I really appreciate it. Yeah, this is Scott, and I've got Adam over here with me.
Yep, yep.
I have to say, really quick, I don't know that I would ascribe the audio problems necessarily to like an agent such as God's. You might be detecting something that's not there. If you ask Michael Dean, he will tell you that I am a magnet for audio problems. And I swear to God, I'm not stupid. I know how all this shit works. But yeah, I don't know.
That's
I have really bad luck.
Sometimes you can put the dominoes in place and... you know, there's just nothing you can do about it. They don't go down like you want them to.
Right.
This is true. Well, no, and Michael has actually said plenty of the same things about me. I mean, I actually have a house that he can't explain, although most people can't explain my house. I've been told by, like, cable providers and phone providers and all that stuff over the years that my house has actually been nicknamed the Bermuda Triangle of Nassau County by multiple agencies, multiple companies, because they just cannot explain the weird shit that goes on in my house. I mean, I am the only person that I know that actually has to restart their house before doing shows. Usually at least once a month I have to do that. You know, most people restart their routers. No, I have to actually reset my entire house.
Like the main breaker?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I have to turn it off and turn it back on again.
Smart meters.
No, I don't have a smart meter. I actually have one of the old school dial ones.
That can't be true.
No, I do, but I have...
Okay, then there's a smart meter on your block.
No, there's no... It has nothing to do with that. I live in Levittown, which is widely regarded as quote unquote America's first suburb, and it was built on the cheap right after World War II, And this guy who owned most of the property here, like, mass produced the town with basically three styles of houses. It's actually one of the biggest square footage towns in the entire county. And they just jammed all these houses in here. They did it really quick, really cheap. Like the old, it was in between the plaster walls and sheetrocking, like the weird stuff they did in between. Yeah, it's got a lot of that going on. You know, wire meshing in the walls in certain places, not in others. And the old, you know, old copper wires that are not exactly in the best condition anymore. So there's, like, you know, electric hums that just fly through all of the entire neighborhood. So yeah. The only way we can get rid of it, we found out. I actually was tipped off to this by like some Verizon guy I was talking to one day. He's like, have you ever tried, like, he's like, this is going to sound weird, but I want you to reset your house. And I just, okay. And we did it. And all of a sudden the problems went away and stayed away for like 5 to 6 months. So I was like, all right, this is what I have to do now.
Hey, Jeremy, have you ever heard of it's called a ground loop interrupter. Do you know what I'm talking about?
Yep. Yeah.
Yeah. I have, I think actually at this point, more than one of those in my Skype mix minus setup and my board and stuff. So I have an older house and I have a lot of shitty electrical problems too. I know what you're going through.
Yeah. Yeah. I tried that. We tried one of those and that didn't really help the problem either. Cause I can actually notice when it starts, cause it starts on my business phone, which is still a landline. And when the problem starts to happen, when you pick up the landline, there's an extra crackle as you're trying to dial numbers and talk to people and stuff that wasn't there before. And that's when things start to go downhill. And that's like, all right, time to reset the house. So yeah, I know all about those weird problems. And Michael is, you know.
The real question is, you still have a landline? That's something that needs to be addressed.
I do. It's for my business, man.
That makes sense, actually.
Yeah. Yeah, I wouldn't. I use my cell phone for personal calls. But yeah, for my business, it was just easier in the beginning to set up a actually have a physical, you know, location and a, you know, answering machine and stuff. So I did you know.
Plus, I'm old school. Sense.
Plus, I'm old.
Well, you can call and get all those phone calls forwarded from the company. You do know that?
No, I do. I do that from time to time. Sometimes when I'm not going to be home for a while, I just have the calls forwarded to my cell phone. But I like having it there. I'm old school, man. I'm 40 now, but my business is now computerized, you know, digitized and stuff, but I still keep all the paper files and back invoices and stuff like that. I'm a pack rat in that regard. I like knowing I have a phone that can still work in most, you know, in a power outage, I can still get the phone to work.
Well, because I don't want to burst your bubble, but most phones now go into a fiber optic backbone. Even the ones like hardwired into your house, they get a VoIP.
I understand that.
Huh?
I understand that, but yeah. There's an old line in the house that still works as long as you have one of those old rotary phones.
You plug that in,
and it'll still work in a power outage. We've tested that. It's pretty cool. So I like knowing I have that around, you know, and it costs me like, what, 10, 15 bucks a month, so I really don't care. But enough about me. Let's talk about our guests here.
Yes, let's.
Well, I have one more question.
Oh, sure, go ahead.
And it may be a recommend. I don't know. It may help you out. Does your microwave perpetually say midnight, or have you like went and spent money on like a battery backup for it?
I don't.
Saying you restart your house all the time.
Oh, I just reset the clock.
Like how often, like all the ones, like the for the oven and for the microwave?
Yeah, but like I said, I normally only have to reset the entire house like once every month or two. So it's not like a, you know, if I had to do it every time I had to do a show, that would drive me up a wall.
if the wind blows just the right amount of speed in Alabama, your power goes out. So we're all kind of used to it.
Well, the same thing happens here. We're on Long Island, one of the few places in the East Coast that still has the power lines above ground, you know, and we live in a wind tunnel essentially.
Idiots. So,
well, unfortunately here, it's kind of like, it's, you know, you're damned if you do, you're damned if you don't, because sure, we could put them underground, but the entire, like, this is built on sand. This entire island, it's an island. I live on a fucking island. We have some of the worst soil in the fucking world. So if you can even call it soil, so it would be horrible if you try to put the things under, you know, and then we have a flood. Oh, then you're screwed. So it doesn't matter. It's like we're screwed either way. It's just annoying when the wind knocks your, you know, you get a little bit of a windstorm and all of a sudden you have no power for 2 days. It's like, really, man? Really? Like, what century do I live in? What the fuck is going on here? But anyway, so back to you guys. So like I said at the beginning, I'm a big fan of your show. I look forward to it every week. So do you guys want to tell us a little bit about that or about yourselves? Or do you have more questions for me? I mean, whatever you guys want to do. We'll make it your show.
First of all, man, I don't think you realize how much that means to me. I really appreciate that. I look up to you guys. I haven't been doing this long. And, all of the fiends I have a lot of respect for, especially like you and Nick, I really dig what you guys do. And, first of all, thank you for letting us, come on your show.
Absolutely.
This is awesome.
Oh, no.
Oh, you guys are welcome.
Yeah, man.
Oh, also, this is the first, I've done the radio locally here twice. This is the first guest appearance I've done on anybody else's podcast.
Oh, nice. We love Papa Cherry's around.
Welcome. Yeah, dude.
I mean, wait a minute. Guys.
Cool.
Yeah, and I also have to say, I don't know if Nick listens to the show, but it is like totally rude that he has not invited us on his new show yet.
The Just Yakking Show.
That is rude.
He hasn't anybody been, you that know, wants to bother him about that and roast him?
Well, you know, go for it. I don't know if Nick, I know he listens to our show occasionally. I will make sure to tag the shit out of him in the post for this show.
I would
like to say, not only have I also not been invited on Nick's new show, but I was never invited on Anarcho-Yakitalism, and I gave that little young punk a ride from the airport to Porkfest. I mean, I saved him a hell of a lot of time and money getting him that 2-hour ride.
And he's been on our show too.
And
it would only be fair.
Yes, we've had him on our show. And that motherfucker lived like a commie the entire time he was at Porkfest, glomming food off of everybody and shit. Lou calls him, you know, the punk juvenile delinquent. I mean, I don't care if he's 18; he's still a punk juvenile delinquent for doing this to us, man. Hell yeah, we're gonna let Nick know about this.
Yeah,
you're a punk juvenile delinquent until you're at least 25.
Pretty much. You got to at least hit your mid 20s before that moniker goes away.
That desire to do just shitty things.
Yes.
Starts dying.
Oh, that still classifies me.
Yeah, I was gonna say that's supposed to die. Wait a minute.
Well, I mean, the desire to mooch off people, you know, don't ever...
It's not the desire, it's the will. The will.
I don't. So you're saying the desire is omnipresent, it's just whether or not you actually act on it is... Okay, yeah,
of course. I can buy
that. Well, it's just an idea before that, right, Andre? So
That's exactly...
Actions
that's right.
are what matter,
that's
right. right? That's how we
that's
define
right. Until the trigger is pulled, it's just the insane ramblings of a bunch of psychopaths.
In most cases, yes. There are the rare, there are the rare occasions where you're pretty sure the person's going to pull the trigger. So let's not wait for that. But you know, most of the time, people are just full of fucking hot air.
If it's Keanu Reeves, he's pulling the trigger. I've watched John Wick. That's all I gotta say.
I still have not seen that. I have that on my
heart. You have got to watch it.
I have it on a
heart. If you like guns, you have to watch it. Well, just on that.
Well,
so
I like guns, duh.
So it was for the audience, really.
Okay. Gotcha. Anyway, so where were we?
Moving on.
ANCAP Barbershop.
Yes, ANCAP Barbershop. Woo! Back to. So yeah, but no, but seriously, man, I'm a fan, and we like to give people an opportunity to meet other people that they may not know about that are doing different types of things and different shows or different activities. So yeah, man, definitely wanted to get you on here. So
thanks. Yeah, we really appreciate it. Our show it's sort of a fluff show. We do a lot of goofing off and stuff. We don't hit the hard topics sometimes as good as you guys do, it seems like.
Really? Because we do a lot of fluff on the show.
That's funny.
Well, that's
there, I'm there. Fluff is the only thing that
that's
happens.
Just
that's
because,
the only thing that happens.
That's just because what you know since you've been here, Andre. I mean, before you got here, we weren't that fluffy. All right, that's not true.
Oh, so what you're saying is it's my fault.
I'm kidding.
Anyway,
I'm kidding.
Scott and Adam were talking about.
Dave and I are very fluffy people in more ways than one. anyway, so go ahead, guys.
Okay. So basically our show is exactly that. It's a fluff show. Our tagline is we want to be your source for libertarianism and anarchy. And how we got started... Anybody who is a fan or a listener of the Lava Flow podcast with Roger Paxton, I am a Lava Flow fanboy before I'm anything else. And I consider myself a huge Fiends and everything that comes from that fanboy, just so everybody knows that. I love everything that's connected to that. But Roger is basically the person who turned me into an anarchist just from listening to his podcast. And I was pretty much like, I've got to get into this. This is awesome. And I always knew I never wanted to do a fully scripted like show like he does or like Nick used to do, just because I'm really lazy.
That's and solid.
Yeah. I can't stay on script if I wanted to.
At least we're honest with ourselves.
Yeah. You know? Yeah. But it's, yeah. That's important. It's not that I couldn't stay on script. It's that I don't want to write a script. I've tried
to write down some stuff to, you know, do like a short 10 or 20 minute video, right. And I just can't do it. I always go off script. I have to let my mind go down those trails.
Yeah, what works really well for us is an idea that came from Nick on one of his anarcho-yactivism podcasts is the mind mapping thing.
That was a good one.
Yeah, we started doing that, episode 5 or 6 in, and we've been doing that a lot. It works pretty well for us. Just bullet points or something along those lines.
Yeah, I use it for a lot of stuff, and I break a lot of the rules that you know, at this point with it, but like if I was trying to figure out what to get my wife for her birthday the other day, and I like made my, I've got one in front of me. We're gonna talk about all this Battle of Berkeley shit on our next episode, and it's like in the middle is Battle of Berkeley, and then coming off of that you have a bubble that says Moldy Locks, and then like like Antifa are fucking pussies is off of that, and let's see what
covering all the bases. Excellent.
Yeah,
that was right. Good, exceptional.
Fought at all. They really don't.
Yeah, it's a good way for me to have bullet points, but have them not prioritized in like a certain order. But
right, just to have a general outline, which
And if anybody listened to
curriculum,
if anybody listened to the interview we did with Greg Glyer of DonorSea, yes. Which if you listen to any episode of our show, like go listen to that one. Because it's just a really good altruistic thing, and also even if you don't give a shit about, you know, starving little kids, it's really revolutionary technology. It's basically crowdsourced charity or whatever.
Yeah, I'm a big fan of that that app. I have it. I try to donate a little bit whenever I can. So I love that thing. I'll definitely put a link to the show notes to that episode.
Yeah. Do that, man. And also B, because I'm really proud of it. It's the only thing like that I've ever done. And for me, that was somebody that was kind of high profile. Like there's somebody that went on the Tom Woods show and everything. And But yeah, just getting back to, I guess, the history of the ANCAP Barbershop. We've got about 15. No, we're about to record our 15th episode.
That's right.
We've got 14 out, and only one of them in the title has a spelling error, as far as we know. So we have 13 that are free of spelling errors, and
that's solid.
That was a whole really, really funny thing.
I think percentage-wise, you're already, you know, worlds ahead of us. We have plenty of them with spelling errors. There's, and there's things that I catch and then later try to correct. Like I go to LibSynth and correct it, and it corrects on LibSynth, but it doesn't filter down to anything else. So it's still messed up everywhere. And I'm just like, you know what? I just don't. I give up. I don't care. Like, what am I gonna do? Am I gonna republish the entire episode? No, it's my OCD is not that bad
it's
anymore.
Just there.
I'm able to let it go. A couple years ago, probably wouldn't have been able to.
The red tape involved kills the OCD. It's like, I hate the red tape more than I hate the OCD.
Yeah, we changed the title of ours, but in the picture of it still says like speech with spelled wrong.
Yeah.
We're not independent. We're on a network, anyway, I'll get into that in a second. But we have our network makes really, really cool pictures that are individual to each episode. And they're like really high quality. If you go look at our Facebook page, it's really badass. But yeah, so this one, I think the spelling errors are fixed like on the website and everything. But as far as like going back and redoing that picture, it's not worth it.
So you mentioned a podcast is kind of what got you down this libertarian anarchy pathway. What was it like? Did you read a certain book, or was it just a certain something stuff that clicked finally, or what was it? Just couldn't deny it anymore.
Yeah, I mean, and Adam can go after me. For me personally, I grew up like super neocon, just believing.
Me too. I mean, I think if you're in Alabama, that happens.
Yeah.
Yeah, you don't have a choice.
Are pretty high.
Yeah. At some point, I heard my friend Dave say the word libertarian, and I kind of started sliding into it, like, just very lightly, not really knowing, like, who Rothbard is or anything like
those
that.
Those damn Daves. You got to watch out for them.
Yeah, they can be good.
All the time. But
eventually, and he actually, for a long time, said, man, you got to start listening to podcasts. You got to get into this medium. It's the future. I was like, whatever. That's stupid. And eventually, I tried it, and I was like, and like, literally anytime I can stick one earbud in my ear, I can be making myself smarter, which I definitely need. Yeah. And I mean, just like searching like libertarian in like iTunes podcatcher. I remember the first thing was We Are Libertarians and like listening to that show. And I still really like that show. But then I think the second one was The Lava Flow. And I remember the moment. It really, for me, it wasn't but a couple of years ago now, whenever I was up on my roof, which you probably shouldn't be working like on your roof with headphones in, but now I was listening to his.
Really? I think.
Well, yeah, okay, then maybe it's not a big deal, but.
You're just up there tanning, Jeremy. Quit lying.
I guess if you fall off the roof, whether or not you have earphones in isn't going to be terribly
irrelevant. It's inconsequential. You just have to yell very loudly.
Yeah, which I suspect you're going to do anyway. But anyway.
Yeah. right. But I think it was he had like an anarchy versus minarchy like episode. And just listening to that. It was I don't know how to argue with this. like there is no legitimate function of the state.
It's solid.
Yeah.
For me, sorry, go ahead if you want.
No, go ahead.
Okay. Mine was pretty much the same as Scott's. I was pretty much just grew up a Republican statist and thought, that was cool. And I've always was real into free market economics. So, and then, I remember it was like a magical moment. I was sitting like on the couch with Scott and we were, he was showing me on YouTube Libertarian Party convention or whatever.
Yeah.
And I saw that one guy. He like put on some music and he stripped down naked or whatever.
That's James. That's James the Week. That's James Week. He's a fiend now.
Yeah, and it was right at that moment that I knew that was the political party for me, it was pretty much that. It's. What did you say the difference between like a minarchist and an anarchist is like 2 weeks or something?
Six. Yeah, that's
usually
that's
about 6 months.
That's the joke.
It's a lot of information to get on a cult indoctrinated mind. It takes a while to disseminate for most folks. Yeah. All of that info. Holy shit, my whole world's a lie. That's right. Takes a while to break down.
It took me a while to you.
It's really new for me too. Like I wouldn't consider myself an anarchist until. I don't know, till about when we started this podcast. And even then, I was like, I'm kind of a minarchist.
Are you an anarchist now?
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah. I figured you were like at this halfway state. I knew it was
kind of... I spend every day like debating it with like my other stupid friends, you know, like just saying, like, no, actually, this is the way it should be.
Enough,
yeah, but... you know, and I'm like, you know what, like, I'm making points for it all the time. Like, I pretty much am.
You heard
you realize it's the most logically coherent. Yeah.
Not just that poorly, you know.
Just so we're clear about what's happening, I think Adam Brown is coming out as an ANCAP on the Seeds of Liberty podcast.
I am very excited about it.
Right.
Best episode yet.
He took the black and yellow pill live.
I was going to ask as he was starting to talk about that because I remember listening and I was pretty sure like even as of the most recent episode where it came up, you were still saying that you still pretty much like were like in minarchist land essentially, right?
Yeah,
it was only like an episode or two ago from what I remember.
So. Yeah. What was the last hurdle? What was the last hurdle, man? Come on.
No, just the peer pressure from us right now. Just like, all right, fine, guys. It's fine. It's 4-on-1 now. Fuck it. I give up.
For me, it was realizing that the state can never, ever, 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 ever functionally equip and handle a military adequately. And we do need a military. Like, communities and societies are going to demand a military to protect them. And the state cannot handle it. And that was the last hurdle for me.
That's I'm sorry to cut you off, and that's crazy. Like even like David Friedman says that like national defense is like the hard sell for libertarianism.
Yeah. Well, yeah.
And to be clear, I'm not that well read. Like I'm still somewhat new. I'm still pretty new to all of this. But yeah, that's interesting.
What drew me to minarchy so much was really just because it was a pragmatic approach. It was more of a just wanting to live morally anyways like that through the non-aggression principle. Mm-hmm. And I felt that like it's the only way was to you know, like get your toes in the water, right? Like start off, you know, getting more libertarians in office and things like that and moving in that direction. Next thing you know, people are going to be, you know, or I was hoping that people would move to that idea to where we could, you know, essentially have an ANCAP community. Probably not in my lifetime, but, you know, that's, you know, it was a pragmatic approach is why more I've always been considered a minarchist.
Well, here's what I tell everyone that tells me what you just said, the probably not in my lifetime. I say, well, I wonder what you could tell the guy right now, knowing what you know, the guy in Rome 10 years before it collapsed. Hey, all of this is going to collapse in 10 years. You better get ready.
He probably would have said something like, take
you're
off
crazy.
The temple hat,
Rome, you know? Rome has been around for 2,000 years.
Well,
yeah. Okay.
But this is the way it's always been done. But like, what are you talking about?
Yeah, but
slavery's not going anywhere. It's an institution.
Yeah. Who it's will still not going to go anywhere when this if well, the state.
Well, but, go ahead, Jeremy. Go
well, that's
go
what
ahead.
I was going to say, Dave. I don't. I get what you're. I see what you're getting at, but I don't think that's a really good example because back then with Rome, there wasn't as much history to say. Well, it's always been like this. Well, yeah, it was, but it wasn't as long. But going in reverse, it's a lot harder for people to step away from it than it is to, you know, because it's even more ingrained now. So. I have no problem saying I don't expect to see it in my lifetime. I'll be happily surprised.
No,
if
me
I
neither.
Do.
But
I don't
for optimism,
for
right?
for people who say that. I mean, I don't see fault with it because I don't, you know, I don't expect to. But to what Adam was, you know, Adam and all you guys were saying about the. You know, the military being that hurdle, and that's kind of what, you know, kept you basically in minarchy. I mean, that I did that too. You know, when I first found the Libertarian Party and I met my first voluntarist, like the first time I had ever heard that word, when we first started talking, you know, we exchanged ideas and found that we aligned like 90 something percent of the way. And I was still stuck at that stage where I was like, yeah, but maybe.
Oh, yeah. Same
okay.
Here.
I see it. But it always came to, and it fine. That was for me, the last hurdle was the military. And I'm pretty sure I've talked about it on the show before. For my red pill in that regard was it's the red pill, right? I always forget the colors. I'm so horrible with that shit.
Yeah. It's chaos. It's the red pill.
It's not the blue pill, Jeremy. That's NyQuil.
Thank you. I do like NyQuil though. But what I, what for me was that little, it's called a book, but it's essentially two essays. Robert Murphy's Chaos Theory, which he wrote like way back when. And it was just like two essays he wrote on the privatization of law and the privatization of security. And they put it together in this little book, and you can get it on free at Mises, you know, Mises.org. They have the PDFs, and I think there's an audio version of it there for free too as well.
I think it's on Cato as well.
I'm pretty sure. Mm-hmm. I'm pretty sure it is. It's in a lot of places. Great little read, and that was it. It wasn't that he gave a solution, and I was just like, oh my God, that's it. We have the answer. We don't need this. Like, government's completely unnecessary. It was just that, oh, here's a really convincing argument for a possibility of an answer that doesn't actually sound as batshit crazy as I would have assumed it would. That's all it took for me. It was just to know that there was an actual option, that that it wasn't just, oh, but there isn't a possible way. Oh no, wait a minute. There is a possible way. People may not want to go for it, but there isn't. Like, that was, for me, was the switch. And I saw it with my dad too. Like, I've talked about my dad before. My dad, I have him almost, he is so close to being an anarchist, so fucking close, which will be my biggest triumph over any other people that have given me credit for their, you know, their transformation. He will be the one, because he was the one who sent me on my path originally, because he was a hardcore Tea Partier. Obama is a Muslim, yeah, lizard person, fucking, you know, whatever. Well, actually, I'm sorry, Pop, because I know he listens. It wasn't lizard people, but Obama was a motherfucking Muslim. He was born in Kenya.
Well, wasn't
all
your
that
dad
shit.
In the military?
Yes, but he had long since, he was in the Navy, but he had long since denounced the military largely as a scam against young, dumb men.
Wow.
But
still,
says,
that nation that you fight
well, exactly.
and live for is
no.
ingrained. It's burned well, into that, you. Know, it's, no. That's the hardest thing is vets, man. That's
well, you're
the
right.
hardest thing.
You're right. He still had that residual part, but like, that's why I said he largely had renounced it. Like, he was the reason I never went into the military, because we didn't get along when I was younger. Like, we actually got, I mean, my 15th birthday, he sent me to the hospital with stitches in my head because he was pissed off at me for not coming home on time and, like, choked me and, like, I fell down the stairs. A whole big thing. And, like, my mom sent the two of us to spend the rest of the night in the hospital together just to piss us both off. It was, like, you know, great way to, you know, that was pretty much when I gave up on birthdays.
Oh, God forbid that happens today. Your dad would be in prison for 50 years.
Well, yeah, but exactly. So we didn't have the best of relationships back then. But the one thing he imparted on me was essentially, don't make the same mistake that I did. I don't really care what you do with your life, but if you end up in the military, I may kill you myself.
Damn.
Go ahead.
That's a good dad.
that's pretty much what he said to me. And I was just like, all right.
Legit. I'll take it.
I'll just say, I think that kind of thinking among like military folks is probably more common than we think. At least people that see, like actual battle.
My dad was a NOM, so.
Yeah.
Imagine you're part of a cult, and then you're a part of the militant wing of that cult. And then imagine you've killed and or had friends die that were
exactly.
Part. You're going to have further than almost a religious attachment because it was much more real than just verbiage and language to you.
And especially Vietnam was a nasty, nasty war. I mean, you had like white phosphorus.
And it was complete joke.
Yeah, of course. Listen.
It wasn't like a joke. A lot of motherfucking people died. Joke is not the word I would use. Farce, but, maybe.
Fair.
Okay, farce. The reasons
for it were a farce, but yeah.
Farce was what I meant.
I know.
Fair enough. I think a lot of people that come back from really seeing the carnage, and I have never been there. I'm not in the military. I never was. I have no idea. But I think they're probably like really used to being told, oh, you know, you've done this honorable thing. We'll hold the door for you, you know, whatever it is. People go so far out of their way to respect these people. And they're probably like, you know, I don't even know if I want that. You know, like I'm actually probably dealing with a real battle of was this an ethical thing? I mean, if you go and kill people, you would have to, I would think.
Most people aren't the same after that.
I know my grandpa was in, and he's actually now, I've heard him, and he's very, like, very, very Fox News Republican type guy. But now I hear him saying stuff every once in a while about, like, you know, I think war is bad. I'm against the war and all this stuff, which I never heard from him growing up.
I had an old guy that was I used to talk to when I was younger. He was part of a thing at school. He was a World War II vet, but he was a counter sniper, he was the captain of a counter sniper unit in Da Nang, or one of the islands outside of Japan. I can't remember which one it was. And he says he gets woke up every night, thinks he's in Japan. It was that traumatizing.
Oh, geez.
Yeah.
Because he had to kill so many. He said he killed personally like 32 men that nothing he could do about it.
Yeah. Jesus. That's such a tough thing, like just having a conversation like that with people who are veterans and stuff like that. They spent such a large portion of their life, you know, dedicated to it.
He thought he was on the good guys.
Yeah, you know exactly. they really feel like the only way to cope with some of the terrible things they're doing is to think that they're doing it for a greater good, you know, and it's so important to them. It becomes such a part of their life. You become like less of a person and more of a soldier after that, and it just is their life, I don't want to try and convince one of them that the people who are cutting their paychecks were crooked and they shouldn't have been doing that. That's not a conversation I want to have because it's such a part of their life, and it's such, like, I couldn't imagine, you know, it would be tough.
But that is a big hurdle for a lot of people. They can't even start to deconstruct, okay, the state is a monopoly that is essentially forcing a monopoly under it for this military. We're not getting market competition in this, and that's the reason why it's so evil. Right. That's the reason. Well, if it was up to the whims of the market and people could respond to its evil or its good, it would go bankrupt or flourish. You know what I'm saying?
Well, the fact that they can't appreciate the lack of market competition probably has something to do with the idea of they don't understand what the phrase market competition means, Dave.
Yeah.
You know,
right.
I mean, I've spoke on this before plenty of times, you know, way back when, you know, in my hardcore status days, which, you know, looking back still weren't that long ago. I mean, I've only been a an openly admitted anarchist for like 4 or 5 years at this point. So, you know, up until then, I was very stubborn and very vocal about my idiocy. And I, you know, I just demanded stupid stuff. I didn't, you know, you can't think past some of these things sometimes. That's the problem.
Well, we all used to be loud idiots, I think, to one degree or another.
Used to.
I'm still a loud idiot. I think I'll always be a loud idiot. I'm a better informed idiot these days.
Everybody in here wants to do a podcast. That's basically we're being idiots for liberty.
Yep.
Yes. Five idiots. Five white boys, of course, too, you know.
Andre's Romanian. Damn whites. Okay?
Hey, I'm white.
Yeah. Well, we're all,
if you say kill whitey, you're talking about me too, because I ain't no Slav.
We're all cis hetero scum. I mean, we should just all admit it and move on with it. I mean, I've tried.
Agreed.
To, you know.
Oh, agreed. Man. We all really deserve terms. To die.
I identify as a M1 Abrams.
Nice. Nice.
One thing I did want to mention, since we're on the military thing, that's actually the reason my time in service was the reason why I finally made the jump from minarchy all the way to anarchy and voluntarism.
Oh wow!
Because
Andre's a vet.
Yeah.
Oh.
I didn't go overseas. I didn't spend any time killing other people. Although I did take the moral responsibility to do so. I was combat arms. I was in the 82nd. So if anyone was going to deploy to engage, you know, the enemy, it was probably going to be my unit. And when the Syria war drums were beating the first time, it was in 2013. What?
13.
Yeah, 13 or yeah, it was 2013.
14. No, it was
13 or 14.
It was 13 when it started. Yeah.
Right. Yeah. So when that was starting to happen, there was a whole bunch of talk about like, oh, we might be deploying to Syria. You know, we might be the first boots on the ground. I'm like, son of a bitch. That was one of the crystallizing moments. But more than that, it was amazing to see how much waste, fraud, and abuse you could actually witness at my level. I was a lower enlisted guy. I wasn't an officer. I wasn't in charge of shit. But like, even at my level, like the stupid private level, it was amazing how much waste there was and how much bullshit accounting had to be done to like basically cook the books so that we could keep getting funding for shit. Like, it was unbelievable. Huh. And then the other part of that, because prior to that, I'd had the same sort of understanding and I guess view of people in the military. Oh, you know, they signed on the dotted line, you know, they're whatever else you think about the wars, you need to support the troops. Well, I come to find out that like there were a lot of really shitbag people in uniform.
Sure.
Like
Dylan Robinson.
No. I mean, not even just because they were in the military, like because they decided to sign on the dotted line to say, oh yeah, I'll totally kill people for political masters. No, I'm talking about like just shitbag human beings. Like, not psychopaths, not, you know, like cold-blooded killers that just want to do it because they want to kill people. No, just like normal, average shitbag people. And these were people that, like, you know, civilians would hold the doors open and shake their hand, say thank you for your service, or like, here, let me get you a free coffee. Guys. I'm like, God, do you realize how many shitbags you're doing this for and how much you're elevating these people? These are people that deserve to be ridiculed on like a daily basis until either A, they leave and you never see them again, or B, they kill themselves and hopefully, you know, you never see them again and never hear about them again. And yet here they are wearing a uniform and suddenly, you know, magic uniforms. They're, you know, the greatest. They are the noble savage. They are the violent men on the wall that allow us to sleep peacefully. Like, really? So that was like a huge eye-opening experience for me. I was like, yeah, this is fucking horseshit.
Let me
this
ask
is
you,
just nothing but horseshit.
You think that's what do you think, the military is like a magnet for people like that, or do you think they turn into that while they're there? And do you think
most of them, I think, see what it is once they get in. They're like, shit.
Yeah,
this thing's
in terms of your question, are you talking about like, does it attract shitbag people, or does it attract people who then, like, once they're in there, realize, oh man, this is terrible?
Yeah, that was my question.
I don't know, because it really depends on the person. Because, like I said, I've served with one person that was explicit in their desire to kill other human beings, and it, like,
he's essentially,
huh?
For sport, you mean?
Well, yeah, because that's what he wanted to do. He wanted to kill other people, and this was the best way to do it.
I've heard that from friends I have that are either Marine or ex-Marine or vet Marine that like I literally joined to go kill sand, you know.
So, no, but I mean, there wasn't. Yeah, but I mean, it was like, you know, there was nothing. There was no bravado about it. It was just very like
matter of fact,
flat. Yeah.
This is a way I can get away with it legally. It was, basically, is the
it
way
was
they see it.
Probably the most terrifying experience I've had with another human being in my entire life. Let me put it to you that way. Wow. Thankfully, we both wore the same uniform, so I wasn't really worried about him deciding to just, I don't know, murder me in my sleep. But
oh, so you met your very own Dexter, essentially. Somebody who wants to kill the one,
just about,
but who's going to try to do it for good reasons.
But beyond that, like any normal, reasonable person in that environment is going to start forming the same sorts of doubts and questions that just about everybody we've talked about is going to have.
Yeah.
Because you can't be a normal, rational person who has some sort of moral compass and then continue to go down that road unless either A, you come up with some bullshit rationalization to sort of assuage the guilt and the unease that you feel for what it is you're doing, because you're going to feel it. It doesn't matter, you know, how much you tell yourself, oh, well, you know, this was for love of country and I'm keeping people safe. And yeah, I don't agree with the politics, but you know, I have a duty, yada, yada, whatever. At the end of the day, that's basically worthless, because at the back of your mind, you know for a fact that what you're doing is horribly, horribly wrong. Something is terribly wrong with what you volunteer to do. So either A, they come up with a bunch of bullshit rationalizations for it, which can either last, you know.
I mean, because you did this as well. I mean,
oh, yeah, totally.
You're saying this from experience, right?
Yeah. Yeah. And either they last, you know, the period of time that they're contracted to be in there. And then once they get out, they can finally like breathe a sigh of relief, like, oh, thank God, I don't have to carry that burden anymore. I can finally like stop lying to myself. Or they ingrain it so deeply into their mind that they begin to believe it. It becomes an
forced
ingrained
delusion.
Belief. Yes, exactly. Yeah. And but, I mean, people will eventually break free of it. Like as time goes on, they start to have to face their own demons. And sometimes that can be very violent. Sometimes that is a peaceful transition. It all depends on the person. But anybody who goes in there, like especially combat arms, because if you're support personnel, you never see combat and you don't really have, like if you're an admin clerk, you probably are never going to have these questions raised in your mind. Because all you do is file paperwork.
You're so compartmentalized,
like
you know?
Yeah, you file paperwork. Like that, you could do that anywhere. And that's basically what they tell you. It's like, oh, well, it's just a job like any other. But when your contract says that you're going to engage and destroy the enemies of the United States of America in close combat, it's a little bit different. And that's when you start to question your morality and your moral compass. And that's when you have to start, like, building these walls and these rationalizations in order to keep yourself from feeling this horrible unease that what you're doing is essentially wrong and terrible. And
because once you gain a conscience of what you're doing, it becomes very hard to continue doing what you perceive as evil and bad.
If you have a conscience going into the military, it's going to result. I can't speak for everybody, but I really think that that's the way it goes. You kind of develop this sort of worldview where you can sort of make excuses for it, even if you don't really believe it deep down. Either that or you don't have a conscience, and this is fantastic.
Tell me what you think about this. Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead, Fishpoint.
Oh, no. I wasn't going to add anything more. I think I just accidentally tapped the mic. Go on.
I think maybe the other side of the coin of that, where for somebody like you're saying that is faced with that moral dilemma, that's really hard to justify. I would say the other side of the coin is people in general, not just military people, it is easy for them to justify like being a monopolist. You know what I mean? I guess for somebody maybe that's not as observant or just, I don't know, hasn't been red-pilled, hasn't thought about it, because people aren't taught, you know, in like public schools to think about it. You know, people don't know what the economic calculation problem is. Right? They're not, you know, where something being communally funded. Communally? I don't know if that's
a word.
You're
up to three-word phrases. We haven't even gotten past the first two-word phrase that they don't even know about, which I can't remember at this point, but I know it was another economic one. So of course they don't know that one.
Place functions.
Thank you.
Yeah, right. And I mean...
One in five can't replace a light bulb right now. One in five. One in five polled. So.
One in five what?
People, human beings, can't replace a light bulb.
Did that like count in like children who don't know how it works?
No, I think it would make sense. 18 older.
Oh.
How do you go about polling for that?
Yeah, I question that.
Because I guess what you would have to use a sample, and yeah. You would just have to do is, I mean, you can't like call
it's
people.
Just like, it's just
hey,
like any other
dumbasses.
Poll.
I mean, it was more of a denotation of how stupid people are, and right. That like you almost
in
have
other
to
words,
talk
Dave
at
was
a
pulling
third,
it out of his ass.
You got to go third. No, it's look it up. You got to go like third grade level with most people.
I'm sure you
and saying these words that were made up by Austrian economics, philosophers is going right. To be hard to translate to the common guy.
In some cases, it's not really going to hit home until you actually see it, which is what, like I mentioned before, I didn't realize, because you can talk about, the economic calculation problem. You can discuss that and talk about it and be like, totally. But surely for defense, they got this down pat, right? That's the one thing that they're really good at doing. And then you get down on the ground level, you're like, they have no fucking idea what's going on.
Right.
And then you learn, and then you like actually take the time to read about it and how like the DFAS, the Defense Funding Agency, the people that actually cut the checks, they literally cook the books every year so that the numbers that they actually spend on paper look the same as what what Congress has authorized to pay them. Yeah. But and like,
didn't the Pentagon lose like $6.5 trillion or something?
Oh yeah, and then they lost $2 trillion September 10th, right?
Oh, it's can because you really, you're buying $5,000 hammers.
Can you really lose something that never actually existed?
Well, okay, now we're getting into point. Like now good we're point. Now we're getting to the next level.
it's debt slavery put on the unborn. That's how they're paying for it.
I understand how the process works, Dave, but I think you get the gist of what I meant.
So what's your goals with the ANCAP barbershop? Like, is it to just entertain, maybe start changing the culture that way through the...
No, it's completely, completely selfish. I really, really enjoy doing it. And hopefully like insurance or something like that through selfish means, hopefully somebody, it helps somebody maybe. I hope. I really, really love, doing podcasting. I really enjoy it. And that's kind of a half-assed joke. I do. There is some altruism in there. Like I want to help people. I want to spread the message, and probably more than anything, it gives me an excuse to learn. It gives me an excuse to connect with people and talk to people. I mean, because since I've started doing this, I've learned just a ridiculous amount.
Right.
And I still don't know shit, but I still, I've learned a lot.
It does the same for me. Like a lot of it is just because like we cover these topics or whatever, and I learn about them as well. I know more about whatever subjects than I used to. By far, and so a lot of it is self-education, and then part of it is, it is a little altruistic, but it's also a lot of fun. One thing we try and do small amounts of philosophy. We don't delve too deep into them. We usually spend 15, 20 minutes talking about a small thing and just how it applies sort of to our political philosophies. And I enjoy that because I think if it can make somebody think, think about a different topic right. In a different way, I generally enjoy that, and I get some sort of good feelings from that.
And I personally would like to at least think that what we do is pretty accessible. I mean, because we're very layman, we're not like overly educated guys.
I feel we're
blue collar anarchists.
Yeah, I feel like people who are new to anarchy or libertarianism in general would enjoy our show more than someone who is very, very well read and understands things,
Yeah, we're not very lofty. We try to keep that
level of things going on at this show too, right. Exactly. Kind of as a gatekeeper type thing. Just so if you're getting new to the message of liberty, you're starting to think about it, you can have a safe show to tell your friends about and it not go completely over their head.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Totally. Exactly. I mean, it's offensive, but it's not. It's like on an intelligent plane. It's not like super lofty. And to people that have been doing this for a while, I try to make it like an entertaining thing. I'd like to think people enjoy our banter. Me personally, a lot of people hate like fluff podcasts, but I love listening to people, just normal people sit and talk for 3 hours. I don't care who it is. I can listen to it. And for if that's like a deficiency to people that are more educated, have been doing this a little bit longer. Well, once again, I'd like to think that the quality of the show is not that it's like really well researched or that we do this full time, but at least the sound quality is pretty good.
Oh, it definitely is.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, there's been a couple of hiccups here and there, luckily I know a little bit about recording. We have decent enough equipment, nothing expensive, but we knew where to go. We're not using condenser mics. And that whole thing is actually funny because I didn't realize whenever I started into this that broadcasting was typically done with dynamic mics. And so I'm like, yeah, I'm gonna do something really cool. I'm gonna use SM57s, you know, because I love the way they make my voice sound whenever I record myself singing or whatever. And also they're you know, they have a proximity effect. You're not gonna get all this background noise. And then started listening to Michael W. Dean, and he's like, yeah, that's and also that's what everybody, yeah, they have like $500.
It's a rookie mistake. Mics.
Yeah, right. But yeah, I'd like to think it's decent quality. But we try, you know. All and the way we do everything, I hope this isn't too inside baseball, but we basically record everything to tape. Whenever we started out, we would put all our ads and junk in our DAW, but now we do everything from a sampler. We record it, bing, bang, boom, which is good, and I knew that would set us up to be able. We're thinking about going and doing like a YouTube channel and doing video of the whole thing.
Oh, nice.
So I'm really good looking. Adam's really smart, and he has a good haircut because I got his hair.
You got the looks and the intelligence. You got
right.
Well, see, we did video for a while. Nothing spectacular, obviously. And you know, it was. Our former co-host Danilo insisted on us doing video because he kept insisting that people wanted to see our faces, and we were like, listen, if they want to see anybody's face, it's probably yours, because he was the one that all like the young hot single mom seemed to like flock to him. It's like this, I don't know how it happens, but
it's a soul patch.
Yeah, it's probably. but other than that, it was a complete waste of time, and the audio suffers so badly. I mean, if you can find a way to keep the audio up and do that, then more power to you. Go for it.
Right.
I have no interest in it anymore because I had to learn how to do video editing on the fly, and I didn't want to do that. And that, now
I'm not.
Now I've learned how to do audio editing, and I'm like, I'm going to stick to that. That's a lot easier.
Exactly. I'm not going crazy. I actually just bought a $25 webcam from Walmart that is like 720p or what. Like we were just looking at it, and it's pretty damn decent. If I get a light in here and somehow disguise the fact that we're in a closet, I think it's going to look badass.
Put a flag up. Put an ANCAP flag.
Yeah, see, now, well, we're talking about. I've got a Bitcoin flag. That's what I was thinking I was going
to
do.
If you do that, then yeah. I think we may have to do a video episode with you at one point, because I want to get I want to get you and Dave both on video being in closets. That would be great. Like this is how you podcast in Alabama. Andre, you may have to get in a closet too.
Right.
I will drive up to Dave's house to get in the closet with Dave.
Dude, there's no room in this closet.
That's
for
all right.
You.
We'll make it work. We'll make it'll it work.
Now we definitely have to do it.
It'll be the closet
ball
special.
Me in here.
It'll be the closet special. It'll be a big thing.
Right.
Yeah, I don't know. Yeah. I don't know. I don't know if you.
Seeds of Liberty in the closet.
Yeah. Yeah. There you go. The Seeds of Liberty in the closet episode. Excellent. I don't think. I don't think you want to be trapped in a small confined area with Dave and that beard.
No, the beard
and all that.
I've dealt with worse things. Somehow. I've dealt with worse things.
This may actually be true because you were in the military, so I don't want to doubt
look,
that.
Look, if you have never whacked off in 125 degree port-a-john that's been used by like a battalion's worth of people and hasn't been serviced in like over a week and a half.
Oh my God.
And Andre couldn't get off unless he smelled duty ever since then.
As I said, yeah, you may just be right about that, so I take that back.
I did masonry, and I did a lot of construction jobs, like roofing and masonry growing up. So I know what you mean there.
You know all about jacking off in porta potties?
Oh, hell yeah.
Hell yeah.
Confirmed Illuminati. We got a confirmed Illuminati Mason on the podcast right now.
That is a great voice. Like that sounds just like him.
He does
perfect.
Dave does a very good Alex Jones and a pretty good Jesse Body the Ventura too. They kind of blend into one another though. Don't try to do
don't
it.
Blend.
Don't do it.
Listen, Jeremy, they don't blend in at all.
See, right now, that was perfect. But once you start doing both of them together, you start losing it every time, man.
It's because Jesse hasn't been drinking his Alexa Pure. That's his only problem.
Yeah, whatever happened.
Speaking of which, can we interest you two gentlemen in fluoride? What is it? The filters that enhance the water with fluoride?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah,
is that right,
yeah.
Dave? Yes.
Yeah. Whatever happened at Tinfoil Wars? Did you ever get...
We're still letting it simmer.
Have you actually done it either? Letting it simmer. That's
Dave. I work all day. I'm sorry.
That's Dave speak for, I had another great idea, but I just left it there hoping somebody else would pick up the mantle.
And if I can be... If I can be honest, everything I know about fluoride comes from a Squidbillies episode, and I'm like way...
Well, I'll help you out. The only reason it's put into water is because the aluminum industry in the United States, they pay senators and local congressmen and everyone to put it in there through lobbying money. So it's...
To get rid of the waste.
Is it a byproduct of aluminum?
Yes, yeah, a byproduct of aluminum making that... It gives you bone cancer, a lot of other stuff.
That's allegedly. Where's my
also keeps your teeth strong?
Where's my pocket alibi app?
Well, calcium fluoride and the one that they're putting in the water is completely different. The one that comes in natural is calcium fluoride. So the one that they're putting in is, I can't remember what it's called, but it's not the same, and it doesn't affect your body the same way.
So what's
sorry to get all conspiracy right at the end of the show. Like, that's true. You can look that up.
What's the benefit to it? Why would they cut water with like fluoride?
Well, you turn a waste stream into a money stream, and you have your ability to bribe and or pay senators. I mean, it's a perfect boondoggle for a huge corporation. Think about it.
I do.
You're selling shit that you were going to throw away.
Yeah, well, exactly.
Yeah.
That you were going to probably have to pay hefty fines to throw away because it does. Yeah.
I think, yeah, if I remember.
And now they sell it to the chemtrail companies and the water companies. So.
If I remember that story correctly, that's what it was. There was going to be heavy fines imposed for the removal of this particular waste.
And they paid Harvard.
Yes, no, okay. they got studies to be done to say that it was perfectly safe, wasn't going to hurt anybody, yada, yada, yada. And they got the senators and congressmen at the time to, you know, bought off enough of them to agree to go for it. And water was put in the, you know, this fluoride residue was put in the water supply.
It's not in all of them, though.
No, in a large...
Some areas banned it. I think Trump's trying to actively ban it. I think he's going to ban the EPA.
I think Nassau County is actually one of those places that weirdly actually has done that. I think the one time I went to go check, we don't actually have any... record, you know, when you check the records to see what the levels are.
But fluoride's not even the big issue in the water. It's it's everything else that's in the water. It's the fertilizers. It's the your sister's it's your sister's birth control pills. It's your uncle's Prozac.
It's making the frogs gay.
Atrazine literally is doing a lot of things that you guys should read up about. Atrazine.
Gay frogs, cats and dogs living together. Utter chaos.
Talking about the gay frogs.
So if that's a real problem, just serious question, do you justify the existence of the EPA for that reason?
No.
Well, the other reason is probably happening.
Probably
signed up. They probably got lobbied.
That's simply not true, Dave. It's all of those big corporations and big pharma, and without EPA, we would all just be dying.
Market failure.
There's the bills. Place. There's bills.
There'd be dead people in the street.
There's
everywhere.
Quote unquote bills on written up right now to abolish the EPA. So we'll see what happens.
And the
Department of Education.
I can't wait for the Department of Education to just go.
That's
away.
Literally the only thing that has God to be done. Almighty. Literally.
No, that is not literally the only
thing. That's the first step. That's the first step, Dave. That's not 48%
of all government employees are Department of Education employees.
If you were gonna pull the plug on one thing, that would be the everything. It would be something to do with the disconnection from the Federal Reserve. Would be
As I say, but that's not a government agency.
It is a de facto government agency, please.
Okay.
Essentially they could, can they rescind their charter at any time? Or is it built-in protections?
Trump could march the army in and nationalize all of them and they couldn't
do it. The government rescind their charter or they rescind their own?
Yeah.
The government, you mean?
Yeah, could Congress vote to rescind the charter?
Well, they could repeal the Federal Reserve Act of 1913.
Yes, because that was that's what enacted. It was an act of Congress that enacted it. So by their own law, by their own rules,
but
by our powers combined.
But the whole state right now is a reflection of the Fed. Like, so if the Fed goes, the state as you know it is going to go. So it's
good.
Real weird.
Good.
Look, guys, I'm no Bill Nye the Science Guy or anything.
My God.
And like I said,
climate change is science, but there's only 5 billion genders. Believe me.
like I said, I'm not that smart. I'm immediately convinced. So where do you go? Where do you go to get fluoride? That's not what we want, right? Oh wait, so we're
free water.
We're against. Yeah. Oh wait, we want water without fluoride.
Fluoride.
Adam's
bad.
Not yes. Adam's not
you
yes.
You have to get How a water filter, and you would have to get iodine, those two things.
Oh, you're a shill for the water filter company.
It all makes sense.
Who do you work
now.
For? Are you working for Brita? What's going on?
Well Brita actually doesn't take Axel, out fluoride.
He is Axel Jonas, so, you know, he does.
I mean, I drink a lot of tap water.
I didn't advocate anybody's specific filter, but just one that says it takes out fluoride would probably be the one you
There are, yeah, for. There are ones that do make that claim and allegedly, oh, I don't have the phone anymore, allegedly do take that out. I think they're I think a lot of them people consider to be up on the up and up, but
the
yeah.
big thing you want out is lead and chlorine though. Like yes. those are the two big ones.
Yeah, those Makes are sense. Those are much more.
Like you just straight Dave can't drink lead companies. Water. You just
that's
straight
not
up
true.
Can't.
That is 100% not true.
Yeah,
I know
it'll drive you
I do
mad
regularly.
It'll drive you mad.
I drink lead. I put lead in my water to drink it. So you, sir,
damn.
Are a liar.
Damn.
I don't know a whole lot about water, but or about the subject in general.
I don't know a lot about water.
Well, it's two hydrogen
There's
atoms
a bumper
and one oxygen atom. Oh, sorry.
No,
and then they combine, and then they make this stuff. It's just called water.
Yeah. Well,
that's amazing.
Yeah, that's nifty. Oxygen.
Stop shilling for the water industry, Dave.
Oxygen super flammable. So why isn't water flammable?
Dihydrogen monoxide.
You know, and hydrogen is super flammable.
Listen, dihydrogen monoxide is no joke, man. It kills everybody that ever touches it.
It's true. Fair.
Everyone who's ever ingested dihydrogen monoxide has died.
Exactly.
It's like it's got a 100%
kill rate,
mortality rate.
Hmm. Yeah. We should ban it, and then, yeah.
Yeah.
The problem fixes itself. It can't kill anyone because everyone will be dead. We can just ban it.
And just to be fair, I don't think it's killed everybody that has, but anybody you know, that has.
Sorry, it will. Yes.
It will. If it hasn't yet,
it's
it
impossible
will.
For you not to touch water because 70% of your body is water. Think about it. Think about it.
Think about it, guys.
Oh,
think
sure.
about it.
Oh, sure. What I wanted to go a little bit deeper before was, oh, let's not go there. But when Dave does, woohoo! All right. I see how this is going. Fuck you, Bama boys. All right. You know what? I'm going to go find some more New Yorkers to do a goddamn podcast with. Fuck this.
No, go find some New Yorkers to be pissed off and yell in Yellow Valley football or something with.
Oh, good luck.
There are some.
Yeah,
some
no, there are. I don't give them.
There actually are pockets in New York City. I got invited recently.
Just not in Nassau.
I got it. There actually are. I think I just haven't found most of them to actually hang out with. But I got invited to an ANCAP meeting that they have out in New York City the other day, and I was just like, oh, I really appreciate it. But the last time I was there for anything but my daughter, I ended up in cuffs. And that wasn't the first time.
You tell
that
them
happened.
That meetings were a spook.
So I did not.
Oh,
there was no need to go that route, Dave.
Oh,
they were not. They were not insisting that the meetings were this very important thing that I had to accept, or I was, you know, evil. So
they're objectively real, okay.
The meetings don't really exist. The people getting together for the meeting
yeah.
exist.
No, yeah. The meetings are objectively real, and if you don't think so, you're an immoral piece of shit God. Statist.
Damn.
Oh, we've got from
fucking commie. I saw that. You posted this screenshot of that whole conversation. What was it, earlier this morning? That was fucking grand.
We were not even talking about economics here, and you're talking about communism.
Everybody. Oh, yeah. I get called commie all the time. It's great.
Hey, when someone brings economics in, if they start espousing communism, I'm going to call them a commie.
Dave calls everybody
a fair.
Commie. Everybody's a commie to Dave.
Yeah.
You tried to pay Jim Jesus as a commie the other day. I mean, come on, man. Yeah, and oh see, God. And Scott gets that.
Yeah, but they're all commies, man.
They are, man. That's what everybody thinks. I got called, you know, commie or a commie sympathizer. People don't know their history very well.
Anywho, I got called a Marxist today, so I mean,
no shit. Yeah.
And if anyone knows, like, if someone called me a Marxist to my face, that I would probably just start violate swinging.
Their nap. Yeah.
Okay.
Didn't you, Scotty, get called a snowflake?
I did. I got what? Who did
it,
that?
It was something about not standing for the Pledge of Allegiance or something.
Oh
like that.
Yeah, yeah. And I was.
Oh
just,
God, flag somebody, a tree. That's like
yeah,
the worst.
Yeah, it was a total Alabama flag. It was some bootlicker guy on some.
Oh
place,
yeah.
I mean,
you're just asking for a bruising there.
Well, yeah, he was totally anybody.
Better stand
you know,
for my flag, boy.
Anybody
you step
around
on my flag,
me,
I'm gonna pound your ass.
I mean, exactly. I mean, just anybody around me, you know, better if they.
I ask every one of them motherfuckers to do that. Are they a Christian? If they say yes, I say, what are you doing with that false idol? And
right there, you go.
And then I get them going down that trail, and then the flag isn't even an issue. So there's a little trick for you guys.
I appreciate that. Yeah. I actually really dig that. Yeah.
What did that one preacher say? He said, if you don't stand behind our military, you can stand
you
in front
can
of them.
Stand in front of them, they line you up and shoot.
Well, he was a preacher for the
state.
It's absolutely
terrifying the way that works. But anyway, that went off on a tangent. Go on, bud.
Oh, well, so basically, yeah, a guy said, yeah, if anybody takes a knee around me, I'm going to whoop up on you. It was a picture. I don't know if you saw the picture of like the soldier guy with his like arm cut off, and it's like, this is why you stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
Bullshit.
I don't get crazy with it. I'm just like, so like, just because somebody is like not an interventionist, like you think it's okay to justify violence against them? And the dude's like, what did he say? He's, oh, you're, look here. He called me a snowflake and he called me something else. And he said, there's too many snowflakes in the world and the snowflakes need to melt or some shit.
Just tell him this snowflake will put two holes in your fucking chest if you lay a hand on me.
I did. I was like, this.
That's all I say to you. You call me whatever you want. You're going to be dead. It won't matter.
Yeah, this snowflake is not defenseless.
Well, that's part of that whole black and white mentality that we were talking about during the last episode with Sterling Lujan. That I ran into again today, which was something I originally we were going to touch on, but we've been going for a while now. I don't know how much, if anything. I know Dave may have to run soon, so we may have to save that. If you guys got some time, maybe we can do a Patreon episode afterwards, so we can cover all that other stuff.
I'm fine, dude. Whatever. Yeah.
So yeah, we'll do some extra time while we're here, I guess. But yeah, that's what that is. That those people that you disagree. Or they even if you don't disagree, but you use different words and they don't understand what you're saying, like people's instantaneous reaction is like, well, you must be one of those snowflakes, you
right,
know?
Right?
If you know, because that's their mindset. Everybody who doesn't agree with me, no matter
you must be a liberal Democrat.
Yeah, yeah, and, right. And the same goes.
It's like,
for,
buddy, I'm the furthest from a liberal Democrat that exists on this planet.
Well, see, yeah,
that's my favorite. Either that or Marxist. Those are my favorite insults to receive. I'm like, you fucking retard.
Well, you probably don't know what a Marxist is, buddy.
Well, most people don't know what Marxism is, especially the people who throw around Marxism as an insult. I don't know. I can't imagine the type of person who would read anything you've written though, Dave, and say Marxist at you, like, where, like, that's got to be like, as much as I hate to use this terminology, that's like ought right to the umpteenth degree to read into anything that you've said and declare you to be on a Marxist.
You would have to make some pretty logical leaps to put me in that one. I mean, I would say over the last 4 years at least, for sure, once I really fully completely understood a lot of the communist model.
No, but I'm saying who would call?
I don't know. Someone told me. Someone called. I was saying, hey, buy Bitcoin, and they were like, Bitcoin is Marxist, and you're a Marxist. How is Bitcoin Marxist at all?
Was that the guy on your thread who claimed that we're encouraging globalism and all that stuff? Basically,
yeah. I told him. I said you might need to go pray about Bitcoin because I went and checked his profile and. I tried to speak his language for a minute.
Oh yeah, because originally, what was his opening line? Back in the 90s, we were trying to stop a cashless society, and now you guys are willingly doing it.
I don't give a shit about a cashless society. It's Bitcoin. As long as no one controls that cash, I'm perfectly fine with it.
Well, exactly. I mean, back then, yes, Bitcoin didn't exist, cryptocurrencies weren't around, and them trying to get rid of the cash in order to further control the money, the government, that is, the Federal Reserve and the government. Yeah, that was a very bad thing. Absolutely. I was all about standing against that back then. I understood that even back then when I was a hardcore statist, I still understood that. I was like, yeah, that's bad. We don't want that. But
yeah, I mean, we're all still against it because I'm sure the Fed would love to do that.
I don't know why they haven't made active measure to just sneakily print a, you know, a ton of money and buy as much as they could. But I, the thing is, if they did that, the market would be able to see it, and they could split the coin and make a complete new Bitcoin that can't happen in. And a lot of people don't understand that because they're not at a level of understanding on Bitcoin that makes all of it make sense for them.
What, are you talking about forking the
curve? Yeah, yeah. If something like that happened.
Oh yeah, you could definitely. I mean, that could definitely happen. I mean, it's happened plenty of times before.
It's like cutting a leaf off of a bad leaf off of a plant that's growing, or a bad limb. You cut it off so the disease doesn't spread. Bitcoin can do that.
Yeah,
it's the first time monetary, you know, market function, if you will, has been keep going like this. There's no state intervention can stop Bitcoin at this point. None. Yeah. All they can do is mitigate.
Right.
And when I say Bitcoin, I mean cryptocurrency. I'm just using Bitcoin as an all-encompassing term.
Yeah, of course.
Well, now, if the government's just turned the world to glass, they won't have that problem.
Yeah.
So, don't give them any ideas, Andre. Jesus.
Well, they had this on the books.
Every
forever.
Doomsday scenario for Bitcoin that everyone gives me, I always say, yeah, but Bitcoin's going to be the last thing you're going to be thinking about then. Literally. Well, food, water, shelter.
What if the bombs drop?
Well,
your Bitcoin won't be worth anything then. Yeah, neither will anything.
But I think
besides any food, water,
bottled water. You're going to be trading your kids for bottled water. Okay, trust me, you're not going to be too worried about Bitcoin.
I think at that point, I think like ammunition pretty much becomes currency.
Well, sure. Yeah. Well, no, of course. But in fairness, I think most of the people that throw that at you, I mean, some of them are just belligerent about it, but I think most of them just maybe be under the misconception that that's where you have all of your money. So if in these scenarios that's where even the majority of your funds are, then yeah, you may be pretty fucked unless you're already stocked up. And even in that scenario, if you're stocked up, but then once you run out, you have nothing to replenish with, you know, or you have to work that much harder to make up for the fact that all that stuff you just lost. Yeah, that inconveniences you greatly. So I think at least in my interactions with people like that, I think because a lot of people I usually have to correct and, you know, say that no, I'm not saying put everything into that. I mean, I don't have
it's about diversification.
Yeah.
So it's just, but it is, as long as those, like, you know, the gigantic EMP.
Just imagine if you were taking 10% of your fiat wealth that is imaginary, doesn't matter, outside of that spectrum that you can use that currency in, and you had just all 10% of your money or your wealth laying around. If that currency you had 90% of your wealth in collapses, you'll still be able to survive long enough to where a job that can start paying you in that new currency or whatnot will be able to keep you back afloat. So that's the main strength of Bitcoin, is slowly being able to side diversify into a safe asset like gold. It's almost like gold. I mean, it's at 1350 right now, so it's above gold.
Oh, I haven't looked in a couple of days. I didn't realize.
Yeah, I told everyone this morning to buy, and it's already up $22 since I said buy. So,
wow.
Yeah, I
terrible
know.
Terrible idea, Dave.
Because unfortunately, Dave, as I tried to point out, half jokingly, but the last time you did this, yeah, it went up like, I think, like 40, 50 bucks after the last time I saw you announce it. But then it plummeted. And unfortunately, you know, most people who... That doesn't bode well for people who are finally, you know, thinking, oh, right, I need to finally get in. And it's like, oh yeah, I bought it and I just made $20 already. Holy crap. And then boom, $300 loss later.
Yeah,
lost $500. Sweet.
They're not thinking like me, who is like selling it.
I know
the wins.
Well, that's why you receive so much flack when you make posts like that, because most people are like, okay, once you explain your thing fully, yes, if there's people who have money to essentially play with in that regard, yeah, in times like this, it may not be a bad idea to buy a couple extra and see if you can make a couple extra quick 100,000 bucks, whatever, and then quickly, you know, sell it off again. And then, you know, but not most people, especially in our communities, most of us can't afford to do that, Dave.
Right.
Well, yeah.
But most of us aren't really not really doing speculative trading with Bitcoin.
Most of my posts aren't for everybody, though. So,
well, maybe you should send them to private.
No, it's not even that. But
Andre, I'll do that.
No, I'm just messing with you.
Maybe just preface them with, hey, Not necessarily. This isn't for
buy at your own risk.
But if or you should at least say that. But like, you know, you seem often like not perplexed isn't the right word. Maybe not as strong as perplexed, but something just short of that. When everybody like gives you flack about it, you're like, but I don't get it. I understand. I'm not saying for everybody. Well, of course, because all you present is like this one or two line thing that basically says, do this. It's a good idea. Yeah. with no caveats.
Make
nothing.
Thousands of dollars with this one weird trick.
Exactly.
I don't want to give anybody bullshit. I just want to tell them my feeling on the subject. I want to tell them what the market, what I'm seeing in the Bitcoin market, what I'm seeing news wise. And here's most people never ask me why. They just say you're wrong or this. The people that are like, why should I buy Bitcoin right now? I tell them, but very few people ask.
Well, because right. Again, so, I think it's partly in the presentation.
Well.
Anyway.
Either way, you should be buying Bitcoin, folks.
See, he did it again. He just can't control himself.
I can't stop it.
I had this conversation with the local coin shop here, the gentleman I buy silver and gold from. Yeah, I said, do you take Bitcoin? Do you trade in Bitcoin? Do you mess with it at all? I said, nah, I've seen that plummet $100, in a day and all this. And he said, it's too crazy for me, And for anybody that doesn't understand and thinks, that's like a detrimental thing, Bitcoin is, probably like a billion-dollar economy as opposed to something like the American greenback or the petrodollar or whatever is like really, really, really big.
Well, currency, you're right.
Yeah. But if you're in Venezuela, then Bitcoin is infinitely more stable than, the currency that they're using.
They need
the
Bolivar.
Yeah.
Right. It's not worth dirt, the Bolivar.
Nope.
Well. No, you're right. And if you're in, like, let's say Panama or Mexico or whatever, and you've got to travel through Venezuela and you have Bitcoin versus Mexican currency or pesos or whatever the Panamanian currency is, your chances of getting robbed are a lot higher from most likely a police officer in Mexico or Venezuela or somewhere. But it's safer to do Bitcoin because you can just throw the device away, go log into your account with a new device across the border or something. It's impossible to steal that right now.
Yep.
Or that's for them to even have prior knowledge of you having Bitcoin on you. You could just say, this is just my shitty flip phone or whatever.
Right. Burner. That's what our good pal Adam Kokesh said whenever he was, and I say that good pal in quotes, whenever he was raided, not to step on any toes.
He's an idiot.
Yeah. He's a celebritarian, and I'm not going to talk shit about him. I don't know him personally, whatever.
We had an episode recently that, what was it called? And Kokesh is no who? What was it?
Kokesh is no Frodo.
Kokesh is no Frodo.
Oh my God.
he's got to get off of being a politician, man.
Right. Whenever his house got raided, they took all of his silver and his gold, everything he had in his safe, all of his physical assets, but they couldn't get the Bitcoin because he had his passkey memorized and stuff. And
yep.
And here's the thing most people don't understand is like if an authority, the ways the laws are set up in the United States, if you're ever asked to provide a password, your answer should be I don't know it or I forgot it. Because if you say no, I'm not going to tell you, you're withholding state evidence.
Right.
So you're
see, I didn't know that.
And they can't force you to tell them a password you don't know. That would be cruel and unusual punishment. Hmm. So you definitely never want to tell them no on the password thing. You want to say, I forgot it. Even if it's your swipe code for your cell phone or whatever, just tell them, I don't know it. Yeah. Sorry.
Forgot.
They're going to say, you really don't know the password to your own phone. You're going to say, yes, I don't know it.
I just forgot it.
As soon as your lights hit, my rearview mirror, it triggered something in my brain. It made me forget it. Sorry, officer.
PTSD, man. You never know.
I wouldn't even give him an explanation.
No, of course not.
I don't remember.
We're just being wise ass. Yeah. Unfortunately, I sometimes have a hard time controlling my mouth. That's kind of how the last time I ended up in cuffs so quickly. But they, largely some of the best advice I've heard given by people from ex-cops to even current cops to just people who have had experiences, cop blockers, all this stuff, is just the least amount of words possible.
Right. You know, even right. that even that one, what was that one lawyer from Florida?
I don't answer questions.
A couple of years back, who was specifically giving out the advice to like hang your stuff in a baggie outside the window and don't even talk to him at all. Like write notes to
him. You got
to
think about everything you're currently saying to that police officer, even your ums and your ahs. That's going to
be
in court.
Used against you.
That's going to be in court. He's going to say, "Hey, look, this guy's hesitating on answers. I have it here on video." You know, it's like you just got to say,
"I don't answer questions."
No, I don't answer questions, or I don't know it.
He's using filler words. He's obviously like intoxicated on PCP or something.
Yep. Yeah. Yep. So, well, on that note, that we've brought things down to, you know, reminding us of how horrible the state can be to us, we should probably get wrapping up. But like I said, we'll restart again in a little while after this for our lovely Patreon subscribers.
All three of them.
Hey now. Yeah. We definitely have more than that. Thank you very much. But so, guys, this was really great. I really appreciate you coming on. And do you want to say anything in closing? And, of course, plug your show before we go.
Absolutely. And we have a really, really cool story. For anybody that wants to, you know, throw a couple of bucks to the Seeds of Liberty Patreon, we've got something that's pretty crazy that we're going to talk about. It's entertaining anyway. Some crazy fucker on Facebook. But yeah, hey, our website is going to be ancatbarbershop.com, facebook.com/ancatbarbershop, Twitter and Instagram. And in the Instagram, you can see my, you know, haircuts I do and shaves. It's some crazy speed lap videos. Both of those are at
Ancat Barbershop. Do you do beard trims?
Yeah. I do it all. I do it all except for, I don't do women haircuts and I don't do
color. Do women. God, you're missing
so Moldylocks would not benefit from any of your services.
I do like beaver trims for like that's the only.
Whoa.
Nice. But like
your wife's okay with that?
I don't do that. Also you can email me feedback@ancatbarbershop.com. Go to iTunes, go to whatever podcatcher, we're on everything. And I have to shout out Pax Libertas Productions. That's our network. There's several shows on there. It's kind of a young network, but running strong, man. And Adam, do you have anything you want to throw in there?
No, nothing other than thanks, guys, and it's been a lot of fun.
Yeah, this has been awesome. I really appreciate it.
Yeah, it's
cool. I had a lot of fun with you.
It was a pleasure having you on here.
Yeah. All right. So, as for us, our Patreon information again will be in the show notes. And if you wanna hear the other stuff we've been putting out and the conversation that's about to happen, consider going over there and checking it out. It's patreon.com/seeds of liberty. And again, we have it set on the lowest setting. So as long as you donate, I think it's as long as you donate a dollar.
A dollar a month.
Does it even have to be a month?
$12 a year, guys. Come on.
No, but is it even a month? I thought it was just as long as you even a one time donation gets you access because we have it set
to
all of our.
Just go donate $12 one time. Boom.
No, I don't think you even have to do that, Dave. I honestly think it's set at all of our Patreons get to see all our the content.
That's you can good. Subjectively, it's set at one, but you can up it to whatever.
I think it's
you
less
want.
Than one. Whatever. Just go put $1 in and then cancel it after that. I don't care. If you want to listen to this, go check it out anyway. So this has been the Seeds of Liberty podcast. All of our information can be found at that not NAP violating website, theseedsofliberty.com, and we'll catch you next time. Peace.
Worms. Peace.
Worms.
Yeah. Ostracizing me on the website, that's how to fix it, because it's all I've been able to think about lately, so I'm working on Jim Jesus roasted my ass.
Want caviar sound on a cat food budget? Creamy Radio Audio by the Freedom Fiends has great free tips so you can sound like a pro without spending like one. The most powerful form of human communication is one person speaking to another. But if people have to suffer through your sound, they'll change the channel and miss your message.
Creamy Radio Audio will help you speak to the world with sound that will make people want to keep listening. Check out creamyradioaudio.com. That's creamyradioaudio.com.
Are you sick of government lackeys who say you didn't build that? Are you tired of elitists who think you need a government permission slip for everything? Everything you do is an A to B conversation, and the government should see their way out of it. Create true free markets by adopting the BIPCOT No Government License. The BIPCOT NoGov license allows use or modification of any product, service, or software except by governments or government agents. Go to BIPCOT.org. That's Bravo, India, Papa, Charlie, Oscar, Tango.org.